want to greet the church in the most wonderful name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In this last day, to be with you as an official pastor in the Holy Harvest. And beginning the year with your communion service is quite a very interesting time, so that as we walk, the demons may never come around us. There are people who take light of this ceremony. They think it's just another custom in the church. But I want to tell you, we are as we are because of this ceremony. Amen. Yes. Don't take light of this common service. It's very important. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you are marvelous. You are great. You are a God who cares, a God who loves. And for that, Father, I want to thank you as we begin this sermon. May you lead us and may you distinctly remind us of what is important in life. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
In the early formative years of Jesus Christ, he had one vision as a great leader. Great leaders have one vision. They don't want to centralize everything around them as leaders, because they know that they are working with people. And so they develop their leadership in others. Those are great leaders. And also Christ did the same in his early formative years in his ministry. He realized that he must develop leadership. And therefore, he went about developing, discovering talents in men and women. And so this time around, when you read verse 43, John 1, verse 43, he found Philip. He found Philip, and Philip was excited as a disciple of Jesus. And so Philip, because of his excitement, you know, I always say, no man will found Jesus and remain the same and never be excited about life. I'm very much excited about life. Jesus has kept me this far, and I don't regret the day I said, Jesus, I want to follow you. All what I do, you know, envisioned in life, Christ has accomplished and is accomplishing. And for that reason, I thank him. I thank him so much. And so while Philip was excited to show that he has found Jesus, the spirit is burning inside. He says, I cannot keep Jesus to myself. So he met Nathanael. When you read verse 45, when he came to Nathanael, Nathanael was one of these men who were sincere in the church. These men who were powerful in the church. These men that you can depend upon. So he came to him, he says, hey, Nathanael, we have found him of whom Moses, in the law and also the prophets, wrote, Jesus of Nazareth. Then, the son of Joseph. Nathanael, look at Philip. It is possible, I just imagine, that sometimes Philip, one time, he told things that did not materialize. Nathanael, look at him and says, are you sure this time around? But he posed a very powerful question. Nathanael said to him in verse 46, can anything good come out of Nazareth? You, Philip, you just guess things. Really? Geographically, at that time, Nazareth, people, the population that was there, only 150. That's how small Nazareth was. Is that true? That you mean Jesus, the one that Moses spoke about, the prophets? Can anything good come out of Nazareth? And Philip, knowing his brother, that I cannot argue with this one because he's the man of the book. He can start preaching, but he says, I'll be brief also. Come and see. You know, it's very important. Sometimes we lose members by trying to preach to them instead of just inviting them. Come and see. Don't try to preach to members, you know, to people out there. Just call them, just invite them. A brief history of Nazareth. It was a very notorious small town. Small as it is, but very notorious. That sat in the hilly area of southern Galilee, near the crossroads of great caravan trade roads. The Roman army garrison in charge of Galilee, because the Israelites were under the Roman rulership, was housed there. Because Nazareth was near the crossroads, people of Nazareth had constant contact with people from all walks of life. A poor reputation in morals and religion on the part of the people of Nazareth led Nathanael's harsh comment, can anything come out of Nazareth? When Nathanael doubted the testimony of Philip, without argument, he simply said, come and see. These words, come and see, echoes Jesus' own ways to prospective disciples in John 1, verse 39. This was the usual term Christ used to use, come and see. They also resemble a similar invitation offered by a good Samaritan woman to help people in John 4, verse 29. After he had found Jesus, he went to Samaria and said to the people, come and see the man. Therefore, it seems likely that come and see is a modern invitation in the book of John. Whether hearers are interested in Jesus or have heard nothing about him, it's very important just to come on their own and test for themselves. The question is asked, have 2,000 years of Christianity changed this world? Is the life of Jesus worth considering or worth celebrating? The question still lingers. The question of Nathanael, is there anything good that can come out of Nazareth? And the answer of Philip still suffices. Come and see. This morning I invite you to come and see the rock that withstood the winds of time. Hear his voice, the truth undaunted, not intimidated by anything. This is the truth delivered by Christ many years later. Grace unspotted, loyalty undeterred. Come and see the flame that dictators and tyrants and despots have not extinguished. Come and see the passion that oppression has failed to stop. Come and see the hospitals and orphanages rising beside the crumbling ruins of humanism and atheism. Come and see the drama threading through 20th centuries of history and art. Handel weeping as he composes the Messiah. and Da Vinci's sign as he portrays the Last Supper. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Come and see. Come and see Abraham sacrificing Isaac, his only son, because of his faith in God. Come and see David slaying Goliath the giant because of his faith in God. See Daniel sleeping peacefully in the lion's den. See the three Hebrew young men walking in the fiery furnace. See Joshua bidding the sun to stop so he can see his enemies. Hear Job in the midst of torture and pain saying, I shall come forth as gold. Come and see the changed lives. The alcoholic now dry and sober. The embittered now joyful. The shamed now forgiven. Come and see the marriages rebuilt in the name of Jesus. The orphans embraced. The imprisoned inspired. Journey into the remotest areas of this world and hear the drums beating in the praise of Jesus. Walk on the death row and witness the prisoner condemned by man and yet liberated by God. Venture into the dungeons of the world and hear the songs of the saved refusing to be silent. Come and see the pierced hands of God touches the most common heart, wipe the tear from the wrinkled face, and forgive the ugliest sin. Come and see the tomb of Jesus, once occupied, now vacant. The grave, once sealed, now empty. Cynics have raised their theories. Doubters have raised their questions. But their preoccupation continues to melt in the bright light of the resurrection morning. Jesus avoids no seeker. He ignores no probe. He fears no search. Nathanael came, and he saw, and he discovered, and therefore said to Jesus, after Jesus have told him. In fact, immediately after Philip said to him, come and see this man, he said, I'll just come. But at a distance, when he was about to meet Christ, Christ started speaking. Says, what a great Israelite. Christ mentioned exactly who Nathanael was. And Nathanael asked again the question. This was a great man. Great people always ask questions. Hallelujah. They don't just believe, they ask. Then he says, but how did you know me? And Jesus Christ says, before Philip called you, I saw you under the fig tree. Now, what has the fig tree to do with this? This fig tree is very powerful. When the children of 2 years were slain, were killed, the mother of Nathanael hid him under the very same fig tree. And this is why Nathanael, after he has heard the answer of Jesus, said, he also said, teacher, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Otherwise, Nathanael would never have believed Jesus. Jesus had to say something which is only known by Nathanael. Says, thank you. Surely you are the Messiah. Now I believe you. And this is a Christ today we are celebrating. A Christ that was a cornerstone in the Old Testament. And he's a capstone of the New Testament. The long predicted Christ is the now presented Christ. The pre-visualized Christ in the Old Testament by the prophets and kings is post-realized in our time. We are celebrating that Christ today. Hence, Apostle Paul says, do this in remembrance of this very Christ. I wish the Lord may give us that power to understand that without Him, we can do nothing. Amen.